Good morning. My name is James Weyman, and I'm the Manager of Industry Initiatives at the Ontario Media Development Corporation. That's a snazzy little reel. I haven't actually seen that version. We updated it recently. I was looking for magazine titles, though, and we could probably put a few more in. I wanted to briefly provide some context around the purpose of this morning's event before I hand the podium over to Matt Hilliard-Forde, OMDC's consultant for the magazine sector, and today's guests. I'm sure that most of you know that OMDC is an agency whose mandate is to build Ontario's creative economy through a range of innovative programs and funding for the film and television, interactive digital media, music, book, and of course, magazine media industries. Ontario's entertainment and creative industries contribute over $12 billion a year to the province's economy and provide 300,000 skilled jobs. Not only are they key to our quality of life, they're also big business, of course. Speaking of big business, several years ago we did a study of the OMDC Magazine Fund, and apart from concluding that the fund makes a significant contribution to the growth and sustainability of the sector, the consultants heard that our clients wanted to hear more about successful business strategies and projects from their colleagues. So this morning is the fourth best practice event, which as you know is titled Content Across Borders. OMDC does a lot of international business development in other sectors, and we thought it would be interesting to share some export case studies in the magazine media business. With Magazines Canada gearing up for FIP 2015 in October this year, we thought that now might be the time to act local and think global. And with the OMDC Magazine Fund deadline coming up on June 24th, it makes sense to hear from your peers regarding what they have been doing to drive company growth across borders. So on behalf of the OMDC, I'd like to thank the guests for being so generous with their time and knowledge and joining us this morning. And I'd like to thank you for coming out as well. We hope it's an informative and constructive session. And now I'd like to turn the floor over to Matt.
Thank you. Peter, would you like to come up? This is Peter Wilmshurst from Allergic Living magazine, and this is Celine MacKay from Pure Green magazine. Come on up, Celine. Content can travel. The web has blown open access to content around the world and also created communities of interest across and despite of international borders. Perhaps your content is of interest to a broader audience than it's currently reaching. Perhaps there is a viable way of reaching that audience, and perhaps that audience is monetizable. In October, the FIP World Congress takes place in Toronto for the first time. The world's magazine media is coming here. There's a conference. There's also a worldwide media marketplace where you can meet media businesses looking to explore opportunities around overseas publishing and magazine, tablet, app, and website licensing. So this is a really good time to be considering who and where your audience might be and explore if there's a value in reaching that audience. If you have a plan to put into action or any other business development project, you might consider an application to OMDC's Magazine Fund, which James mentioned, and the deadline is coming up on June the 24th. So we hope that you come away with whether you're thinking about an international strategy for the first time or you already have one in place, we hope you come away from today's session with some food for thought and some inspiration. Peter is the publisher of Allergic Living magazine, which has a successful US edition alongside its Canadian edition. Celine MacKay is the founder and editor-in-chief of Pure Green magazine, which in addition to being available in Canada, is in over 40 retail outlets in 12 countries outside of Canada, 13 countries if you consider Hong Kong, a country, and I checked online and nobody seems to know whether it's actually a country or not. This is a conversation that begins with print as a foundation for both Allergic Living and Pure Green magazine, but it also spans other platforms too, and we'll be hearing a bit about that. So Feel free to ask questions as we go along. Raise your hands because we're going to be traveling a mic around. This is being videoed, so we need good audio for those questions. So just raise your hand if you have any questions as we go along. So, Peter, we're going to start with you. I'm going to move around a bit. So if you could just tell us a bit about the world of allergic living, what it is, what's the subject matter, who the audience is.
Okay. Allergic Living was launched in Canada in 2005 as a Canadian publication. We had a website at the same time, but there's no question our focus was much more on the print side of things. We continued to develop the site, but anyway, we found ourselves in a situation that we're a bit unique because our content is, it's difficult to generate because it's health oriented, and I mean it's a lot of detail goes into it. We do it as a quarterly. It would be very difficult to do it more frequently than that to sort of get it out. And we found ourselves in a situation like a lot of publishers that we were in need of revenue. Revenue, no question, sort of started our thinking in terms of heading south of the border because we really did not have enough publishing opportunities in four to generate enough revenue to really make the whole operation really viable. So, I mean, our starting point certainly in terms of going to the U.S. was revenue driven, but we also at that point, we were making use of specialists in the U.S. from day one. We were connected to major doctor groups and a lot of that. So, I mean, it wasn't maybe that difficult a transition, and I'll talk more about that as we sort of get into it. But we're a healthcare publication, but we're not a healthcare publication for doctors, even though we work closely with them. We're very much patient or family driven. The world we live in is the world of allergy, which covers a lot of real estate. Food allergy, I would say, is the core to our business. Food allergy is, you'll read about it in terms of nuts and you know, peanuts and other things like that. I mean, anaphylaxis is a term that some of you may have heard, the type of thing that someone could potentially die from that carries an EpiPen. That would be the most severe situation of allergy. Beyond food allergy, there are an awful lot of different environmental allergies. Asthma, as an example, is an environmental allergy. So is pollen. So the range goes from things that are very serious and life-threatening to things that are difficult to deal with. I mean, I won't make light of somebody who deals with hay fever. I mean, it can be pretty debilitating if you have a bad case of it, but you're not going to die from it. So we cover that whole range. And indoor allergens, you get things like dust mites, cat dander. I mean, it goes on and on. There's a lot of stuff that affects you in home. So there's a broad spectrum of various forms of allergy we deal with. But I would say that the biggest part of it is the stuff that really impacts people, like food allergy, and that drives us into a marketplace where basically we're dealing with mothers. The incidence of allergies are much greater with small children, so that is a big part of our target group. But we also are very involved in the community that we deal with, so I would say that our audience extends beyond patients or mothers and families actually into the community. In a sense, we look at the doctor groups as part of our audience because we influence a lot of things that are going on. We deal with associations that are dealing with public policy, whether it's legislation. They're part of our audience as well. So it's a pretty broad net, but that's sort of where the allergy world sort of...
And you're in print, you're on the web, obviously, Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest a little bit. Are you mainly newsstand? Are you mainly subscriptions?
We're not a controlled model. Subscriptions are part of our business platform, although they are not an enormous part of our revenue base. Subscriptions would be, I don't know, maybe 15% of our total sales, and I'll get into our distribution model and how we do that. We are certainly continue to push for subscriptions. Magazine subscriptions are a difficult thing these days to come by, and we can talk more about subscriptions. But you talked about the other platforms that we're on. Our site is, I think, reasonably robust. We're at about 1.5 million visits a year right now. We've shown a few things early in the year that give us reason to believe that our upside is a lot bigger than that. We had 250,000 people in the U.S. in the first 6 weeks of the year, and I'll talk about how that happened because that's sort of part of what we do strategically as well. Mm-hmm. So the site is fairly robust. Our Facebook is at just over 60,000 now. Twitter is, I think, 13 or 14,000, something in that range. Yeah. Pinterest, not as much, but basically Facebook and Twitter, and they're a huge part of our world right now.
Yeah. Okay, we can talk a bit more about that if it's relevant.
Right.
Okay. Celine, tell us about Pure Green.
So Pure Green is, first and foremost, we are a magazine, but really we're a media group. We publish across three platforms, which is print, digital, and audio. And our mandate is an inspired conscious life. And we started talking about sustainability years ago, like in 2007, with regards to, we wanted to have a unique voice in the conversation of sustainability. We found that there was so much conversation that centered around many of the same things, the same issues, which are really big issues, but they're daunting, and sometimes they feel a little oppressive and negative, things like climate change and things that is hard to do anything about, or it feels that way on an individual scale. So we switched over to talking about inspired, conscious, beautiful living. So living with a more mindful attitude to the resources you're consuming, the things that you're doing in your life. It's very health focused as well, because those worlds tend to run together. And that has been really interesting, because we are very, very unique within that conversation, which has been nice because we've gotten lots of attention because of it. And right now we print, there are copies on the table, which I noticed some of you were looking through. And we print a magazine three times a year, and the print value is very high, the content and quality is very high. And so as a result, the magazine is less of a, it's more like a book almost. The content is designed to stay relevant, and so our readers, the benefit that we have is that our back issues continue to sell. Like, we're still selling copies of volume one, although it's almost sold out. So like, that's been a benefit to doing what we do. But the emphasis on it, on our conversation, definitely relies on that inspired, conscious living.
Who would you say is your typical reader?
Mainly women, aged 25 to about 40, medium to high income. But other than that, I mean, it's very, very broad. So, but that is our core reader.
And you are not on newsstands, is that correct? So just talk
That's
a little
correct.
About the decisions around the print distribution in sort of in Canada, the initial instincts around that.
Well, we began online first. So we had a digital magazine first and foremost, and we grew that to quite significant numbers and decided to launch in print at that time because we felt that the market had proven that there was definitely an audience there for us. But it was definitely eye-opening to think about launching in print. And newsstand is the traditional way of distributing your magazine. But what we found is that it just, your revenue is so largely tied to advertising. And sell-through rate on newsstand is really difficult. You're highly, highly competitive. But more than that, being a sustainable magazine, we were less than thrilled about what happens to all the magazines that aren't sold on newsstand. And when we were putting in the time and the investment into the quality of our magazine, it was something that I just had a tough time swallowing. And also, I had to make sure that I could cover the cost, actually, of just losing, you know, up to 70% of my print run as a result of that. So for me, the visibility of the newsstand wasn't worth it enough. So we went another way. So going more the high quality sort of book way, what I say is that we're reader supported, meaning that we don't have advertising, very, very little of it actually. It's different online, but in print there's very little advertising. That means that the cost per issue is higher, but people are investing in the quality, and there's a trade-off there that seems to work fairly well. And other than that, the majority of our business is actually wholesale. So we sell direct to stores. We have a network of retailers around the world, which continues to amaze me. It's fantastic. The benefit to that is that all sales are final. And so that is actually the bulk of our revenue and our model. And the newsstand decision was definitely influenced by the cost. The barriers were cost and the pulping, the unsold issues. So, yeah.
Thank you. So we'll go into Allergic Living's US expansion now. In 2011, you launched the US edition. So what was the reason for doing that? What was happening in your world at that time?
We knew fairly early on that it was going to be difficult to run a real good, solid, viable business in Canada with only four publications a year. And I think almost from inception, we were building relationships with people south of the border, because a lot of them, in terms of major doctors and stuff, they were actively involved in a lot of the content of the magazine, sort of because a lot of the work that's going on in our area is south of the border. We were ready to go actually as early as late 2008 or early 2009. And the U.S. economy went south, as everybody knows, for a short period of time with all the subprime stuff. And we basically sat back and said, it's not an ideal time to be launching in the U.S. By the time we got to 2011, we just said, we don't care. Like, we just really want to get down there. So we just sort of took the plunge and did it. I guess one thing I'd say, and it's not really part of the question Matt's asking, but we didn't quite know what we were getting ourselves into in terms of going south of the border, because it was a new sort of thing to launch a business in another country. I mean, we went the whole way in terms of accountants and incorporation, and I mean, we file with the IRS and do the whole thing. We have employees south of the border as well. It really was not that hard, which is interesting. So for anybody who's thinking about it right now, and anybody wants to talk afterwards or contact me, I'll be glad to help. It's very doable. If you've got a product that there's a demand for, I mean, which is the first question you're going to ask yourself in any market, whether it's Canada or anywhere else. So with our decision to go south of the border, we did four issues a year. We didn't just take the Canadian product and drop it into the US market. I think that would have been a real mistake. And when we get to the end of this presentation, we'll talk a little bit about, are there any bits of advice you would end up advising. And I think you have to know whether or not you're exporting content or whether or not you're developing new content. We develop a lot of US only content inside the magazine. I would say it's maybe half of our existing content plays in both countries and is relevant to both countries, but to be as relevant as possible in the US, I would say at least half of our editorial is uniquely US content, which is an interesting thing. That's sort of just the what did we do, publishing four issues south of the border type of thing, the same as Canada. I think a more interesting thing is how we went across the border. And once again, this is something that worked for us, and it's a great thing to encourage other people to do if it fits for your particular situation. But we had a variety of partners south of the border, not financial partners, not even editorial partners. I'd call them sort of strategic partners. They're people with a shared commitment to the community that we represent. These are huge not-for-profits in the area of food allergy, in the area of asthma. We do stuff in the gluten-free area, same thing as well. We took the three largest not-for-profits in the US and really bonded and connected with them. There are 200 food allergy support groups across the US. We know all of them. We're in touch with all of them. Our magazines go to all of them. They're engaged with the community. We know the doctors' groups very, very well. The leading researchers we know well. So we kind of networked ourselves into the community. The reason that's important is, it first of all, it gave us instant credibility because we had these people in our corner helping us out. It really helped in terms of awareness of the magazine because they jump-started it right from day one, because they were talking about it to their world. And in a sense, they were a big part of helping us get established. One of the things that we did for them was that they did not have a media outlet to get their word out. So we very much embraced a lot of their causes and the things that they were doing. So, I mean, it's very synergistic between them and us at the other end. And it was fabulous because, I mean, we got the benefits of a lot of hard work and some great people who were very committed to the same community. And when we applied to OMDC for some help starting out, I know one of the things that Matt and I talked about that I think gave him a sense of confidence that this was going to work was the fact that we did have such good relationships with people already south of the border, which is huge. If you can do it, it's great. I mean, tap into the people that are there and make them your friends and your partners, because it can
So how did you go about cultivating those relationships? Did they come to you? Did you go to them? Or was it kind of growth at the same time?
In the majority of cases, we kind of shared common goals. A lot of times, we did an awful lot of advocacy work within our community. An example, one of the more interesting ones maybe, was to try to talk about food that was served on planes. If somebody has an anaphylactic attack and they use an EpiPen, that's not an end in itself. That's a buy you time while you get to an emergency in a hospital. You have an attack at 30,000 feet, you got a real problem. We recognize that. We started doing advocacy work in Canada with Air Canada and WestJet. Very quickly spread to United and other airlines in the states that we got involved in. A lot of the partners we had in the states were very concerned about that as a cause. Other things would be education in schools for teachers to know how to deal with it if a child has an anaphylactic attack. So we were doing a lot of lobby stuff at the same time, which is a big part of sort of what we do. I mean, we have a commitment to the community that we're involved in. It's not just a financial thing where we sell magazines. It's given us acceptance, and so for a lot of those people, they knew about us because of the lobbying we're doing. They came to us for advice. In some ways, I mean, one of the questions Matt passed on early on was sort of, what are you type of thing? You know, and I mean, and I started out by saying we're a media company and thinking that, okay, yes, we've got a magazine and we've got a digital platform and social media and everything, but we're kind of more than that. I think we're advocates for the community we represent. We're consultants for a lot of people, for advertisers. If we get into advertiser engagement, we'll talk about that. So for a lot of these people, they knew about us to begin with, and some of them actually reached out to us, so it wasn't a tough transition. We didn't have to go sort of say, please be our friend, we're coming to the US to launch a magazine. They already knew about us.
So on the one hand, you were cultivating these strategic partners in the communities of interest that your magazine was focused at, but there was also an advertiser engagement strategy as well.
There was. We've become quite expert in our area. It's just one of the things that sort of has happened through the years. We also, awareness for us in the US is mostly driven through our website. And our editor has a very, very strong news background. She's very senior at the Globe and Mail for a number of years, and she has that sort of eye for news, and she jumps on it and moves quickly on it. And a really good example would be, In January this year, the FDA did a recall of cumin as a spice because it had some contamination issues with food allergens. We broke it before just about anybody, well, I think we broke it before anybody in the US and did an incredible job on it. We had a quarter of a million people on our site almost overnight. We basically became the focal point for the whole community in the US because she was fast jumping on it as a news story because of that news type of background. Sorry, there was a question again.
Advertisers.
Advertisers. When something like that happens, I guess I don't reach out to every advertiser because that would be prohibitive, but I would say maybe our top 15 or 20, I'm on the phone to them when something like that happens because I want them to know about it. Their customer service groups are going to hear about it. It's something that we probably are going to learn about before they learn about. We get on the phone and we immediately share that with them. We try to use sort of our knowledge and our insight into the community to help them in terms of the running of their business. I think it also probably helps because they see that we're fast off the mark and we're sort of right at the eye of the storm on most of these things that happen. I think that gives us credibility. So, I mean, when we do something that is sort of good for the community and also shows that we're right in the thick of things, I think that really helps us with advertisers from an engagement standpoint. And we can also take some of our skills that will help them in terms of their running their company. We also have a very appreciative audience, which is very wonderful for our editors and very nourishing for them because you're dealing with moms and small kids. And I mean, if you do something to help a kid get through grade one when they feel like they're set apart because they've got a food allergy and they can't eat with other kids or they've got to be careful and stuff, we get these wonderful, wonderful letters and we feed them out a lot to our advertisers and it makes them realize that there's kind of an engagement factor with our customers who are also their customers. So,
and when you were moving into the U.S. or thinking about moving into the U.S., was the value of your magazine and its audience self-evident to the advertisers that you were approaching, or was there like a courtship process?
We're unique. We're the only magazine of our kind actually in the world. which is interesting. There are gluten-free magazines, that's part of our platform, but when you come strictly to food allergy, we are really one of a kind. So it was new. They weren't, I mean, their media buyers weren't used to looking at print because there weren't print options out there. So, I mean, we had to sort of go through the introduction process. But very quickly, when they actually saw the publication and we had letters from the people that are our strategic partners saying, hey, there's something new out there that's really going to make a difference, and we're helping it get distributed into the community, and they're reaching the right people for you. It wasn't really a tough transition for advertisers to accept us.
Okay. I have some more questions, but we'll go over to Celine. So your website says that you are in 21 retail outlets in the U.S. Mm-hmm. It might be 22 with Stag and Vine. Is that?
Wow, you're really current. No, that's in Canada.
Okay, that's in Canada.
Yeah.
And internationally, in 21 retail outlets in 12, 13 countries, Australia, Singapore, New Zealand, UK, Thailand, Switzerland, China, Hong Kong, Sweden, Belgium, Greece, Japan, Germany.
New Zealand.
Mm-hmm. How did this come about? Like, what was the first step, and then what happened beyond that? That's a lot of countries.
Yeah. Well, first of all, we send actually quite a lot of copies over to Asia, which is really it surprised me at first, but then they have sort of really invested a lot of time and energy into sustainable living, and they're more sustainable tech, where we are appealing to a different market. But that's just been a really, really interesting development to sort of watch, and the numbers are strong there, which is awesome. But I think for us, in some ways it's difficult to know. The growth has been fairly organic in terms of our international presence, because we started online and there's no geographical borders online, and because we're so unique and there really is no conversation going on about sustainable, slow, conscious living like we're doing, I think that's gained us a bit of visibility, and also being extremely present online. So we're really invested, and building community is a really big thing for us. But with our wholesale business, at first we started by reaching out. So when we launched in print, there was a group of other magazines, about five of us, that were doing a similar, not niche in terms of content, but in terms of the business model. There were a few. And so that was actually really advantageous, because we were able to approach the market kind of as a group. We've all kind of diversified. Some have survived, some haven't. Some have grown in other directions. But so at first we kind of piggybacked off of each other and approached retailers as a group, and then afterwards, like, that sort of got me in stores initially, and then after that, it's all been organic. I get reached out to by stores organically, which is the best possible scenario, which is fantastic. Yeah.
What was the first country outside of Canada that
the U.S. absolutely, yeah.
And then after the U.S.
Probably Europe, a few of the stores in Europe, and then Asia quickly after that. And I don't know, were you going to ask the question about licensing after?
Yeah, okay,
so I'll leave that for now.
So it might be my next one even. So they are purchasing wholesale English language editions, and they're selling those. So there's no translation.
Nope.
Okay.
No, we are selling the magazine exactly as you see it, and that's been it's been both a challenge and a strength to create content that has a very little sense of place but feels relevant to everybody, and that's been you know, storytelling, and the strength of our visual content is really key in that area. And it's been something that has worked well for us and is definitely one of our strengths, but definitely also a challenge to create content that people feel they can relate to no matter where they live, even if they barely speak English. So,
right. Mm-hmm. Content licensing. Mm-hmm. Is there any of that? Have you been approached for that? Have you delivered on that?
When we first actually very, very early after, like, I think we were only on issue 2 in print, we were approached by a publishing group in France that who wanted to license our content. And that was... It wasn't an area that I'd given much thought to, but actually as I became educated and my eyes were opened to actually how much content actually is licensed within magazines, even magazines here in Canada that you know and you think, you know, you perceive that content to be unique, but then you see it in a UK magazine, exactly the same. So that, you know, it happens a lot. So we were open to the idea. It took a lot of legwork. And in the end, I'm not sure that it contributed much at all, actually. I mean, it certainly financially, it did for a while. It was a nice cushion, sort of took the pressure off as we were starting to grow our own magazine. But in terms of our visibility and in the strength of our own publication, it barely played a role. So. Okay. It's really interesting in that way. I'm not close to it for further opportunities, but that opportunity we actually severed. So it was just, yeah, it was a really interesting learning opportunity, actually.
What level of management is required to maintain your international distribution?
Well, so that's actually a tricky thing because... So the advantage to newsstand is that you have a distributor that does the work for you. You send them a big bulk shipment, and then they're distributed it on your behalf. Whereas for us, we manage that ourselves because we're dealing with independent retailers. In Asia, there's a couple sort of distributing groups that we deal with, except that really we're still their point of contact. So it's a lot of work to reach out to them and to stay on top of those relationships is... It's definitely a lot of work, but there's a lot of reward as well. And then with our readers, I don't know how much we're going to get into digital strategy, but that has been absolutely key for us, is our digital presence and managing that well. And absolutely everything we do is based on building community. So, yeah, it's a lot of work, though.
Okay. Yeah. We'll mm-hmm. touch on that, I think, because it's interesting. Mm-hmm. Pisa, so for you, you had your Canadian quarterly, you now have a US quarterly with 50% US specific content that you're creating for that.
Yep.
So there's additional time, additional resources required to feed and maintain this this US edition.
Yep.
Is it working? Is it profitable?
It's absolutely, I mean, it is profitable. I mean, we're a lot more viable financially now than we were when we were sort of Canada only. We've had to add resource predictably. I mean, you can't sort of add additional work without adding resource, but I'm not quite sure where to go with the question.
So, this question. So what's working about this, having this additional edition and territory that you're serving?
A lot of the work that goes on in our area when you're talking specialists and stuff isn't limited to an individual country. And I think in a lot of ways we're a lot stronger just because our network is broader right now. I mean, we actually have reached out as far as we did a feature story with an expert doctor in Germany that's leading the charge on research in a certain area. And I think the more I shouldn't say global because North American is not exactly global, but the more you reach out, I think the stronger and better it makes you. Interestingly enough, it's one of the questions that I know is in there, but I'll sort of jump to it right now. And that's, Matt had said, sort of, were there any surprises that came out of it? Certainly from an advertising standpoint, there absolutely were. And that's one of the very unexpected but pleasant benefits is that we found that an awful lot of the people that we brought in as U.S. advertisers also have Canadian operations and didn't know enough about the Canadian market to really know where to turn in terms of advertising their products. And we have picked up a lot of Canadian advertisers through starting out by getting the U.S. one. I mean, it seems to be a standard question for me now when I pick up a new U.S. client. I say, do you do business in Canada? And invariably the answer is yes. And I sit back and say, are you doing anything sort of north of the border? And they'll sit back and say, we would like to, but we really don't know where to start. We're not going to get an agency up there because it's not big enough. And we say, well, hey, we're your people. And we've picked up a lot of Canadian advertising sort of through the U.S. end of things, which is sort of a bit unexpected, but certainly nice.
Okay. And can you talk a bit about what hasn't worked? Maybe things that you tried or expected and then didn't transpire?
I think if you go right back to our launch, and it's funny, I've still got the notes from sort of original meetings that we had before we decided to publish. I think a lot of the assumptions were very, very close, and a lot of what we were doing content-wise is the way we've shaped it editorially. But I thought that magazine subscriptions, paid subscriptions, would be an awful lot more robust than they were. Mm-hmm. And I mean, there's no question. We're not going down the road of a free digital publication. Paid subscriptions are part of our model, but I would say the level of subscriptions is lower than I thought it would be starting out. Matt said sort of, you know, what hasn't worked. I'm a bit stubborn. I'd say what hasn't worked yet. We're sort of still trying to figure a way of cracking the nut type of thing. I mean, I think next issue has muddied the waters a little bit in terms of the price of subscriptions, because we're certainly not capable of selling them at the price levels that they're offering subscriptions for.
Does everyone know what next issue is?
Next issue is a collection of magazines where you can buy over 100 magazines for, what, $100 a year, something like that?
Something like that.
And really excellent titles. I mean, Condé Nast is into it, Hearst Publishing is into it, Rogers is into it up here. I mean, the titles are spectacular. I'm not sure where people find the time to read 100 magazines. I don't have 100 have that time, but certainly the titles are not a problem. But I don't think it's been outrageously successful, and in some ways it's put pressure on people that are trying to charge full revenue for their publications. We're doing it a little bit now through trying to work with some of our strategic partners. We more than likely will try to build magazine subscriptions into our relationships with people like EpiPen, which are very logical for their customers as well, where we provide a fair amount of value for them because they have a stake, I think, in trying to educate their customers and keep them safe. It's part of their overall business strategy. So we're looking for alternate strategies. It hasn't, I would say, worked as well as I would have liked it to have worked to begin with. It's an important part, but it's not as big as I thought it would be.
Yeah.
So I'd say that's probably an area that was a bit of a continuing struggle, let's put it that way.
Right, okay. And Celine, what's working for you and what isn't working for you about the international distribution and international presence? That you're willing to share.
Yeah. it's a complicated question. you know, there's a lot of things that are working really exceptionally well, that being the building of the community mostly. Building our own brand and being able to forge our own path has been a really exciting way to take it. Also, super challenging though. I have found that, you know, the industry, the magazine industry hasn't necessarily been friendly to small micro publications, and so we've had to forge our own path with absolutely everything that we've done, and even things that sound simple like shipping and fulfillment and all of that. Being based in Canada but having such a large proportion of our readership outside of Canada has meant that we've had to outsource a lot of that, and finding people that will work with small numbers has been really, really, really challenging. So, you know, if you're considering moving to the U.S. or into international markets, and if you're not able or willing to stretch yourself to fit into a traditional mold, that's been the hardest part, is trying to figure out all the logistics from afar. And mm-hmm. and so, yeah, that's probably been our biggest challenge.
Okay. Mm-hmm. This leads, I think, into the next question somewhat. How does knowing that your content is distributed and consumed beyond Canada affect your role, A, as a publisher, and B, as an editor? Peter, I know you're not the editor, but maybe you can speak to that.
Yeah, I mean, I think for us to be successful, I mean, a big part of what we do is we have to be really good from a content standpoint because we're dealing with an area that is so important to people. I mean, it literally is life and death in a lot of cases. Content and quality is basically everything for us, and I guess relevance to families. And I guess we're very conscious of not just taking material from one market and dropping it into another market. It can work for some publications. It doesn't work in our particular situation. I mean, when we're doing things like talking about legislation in schools or in product labeling or stuff like that, totally different between Canada and the U.S. So I guess from going into another market, you're saying, I mean, editor responsibility, publisher, to me it's one and the same. Okay. We just have to be very conscious of what information is relevant that's going to mean something to our audience south of the border, and we don't assume that it's necessarily transportable. Some parts of it are, but a lot of it is not.
Yeah. So. And Celine, earlier you said that you have this awareness around content that's reaching people whose first language isn't necessarily English. So was that a realization from the offset, or was that a kind of creeping awareness?
It wasn't a realization from the outset, actually, because what we started doing, it was very much around the conversation that I wanted to have about sustainability and the type of life that I wanted to lead personally. And so storytelling and the visual strength of our content has definitely been my forte. And so that has transcended time and place. So, I mean, it's definitely without having a sense of like a neighborhood or a community that you're drawing from where everyone has as a place, a physical place in common, it's definitely made it a little bit harder. Mm-hmm. But I mean, the readership and also our content is very global. So we have the benefit of receiving submissions from people around the world. And I'm always, you know, I'm extremely... selective about the submissions that we actually publish, but there's just so much richness in content that we have access to because of our global presence that it really hasn't been an issue.
So, okay. Mm-hmm. Any questions? Yes, Stefan, could we, this lady first.
Celine, you mentioned that the difficulties in figuring out how to get your content outside of the country from afar. Do you do much traveling to get yourself established in the new locations, or how do you go about that?
Yeah, I would love to say that I do, but I don't actually. I'm very tied to home because I run another business, plus I'm the mom of a 2-year-old, so it's really, I'm very, very, very busy. And so I don't travel as much, and for me, the community has been like 100% digital in its nature. But because we are so centered on community, it's been almost effortless. So I would love to introduce that element one day soon, but it's just been a cost that we haven't had to incur right now. So, yeah.
And over here.
Hi there. I just wanted to ask a very simple question, and that is, how many are you printing of these, and how many are you printing of the Allergy magazine? Also, I wanted to ask about the podcast that's inside.
Yeah. We print only 2,500 copies, but they're distributed, like as Matt said, around the world. So our density is not super high, but our reach is really, really spread out. Our readers are very, very loyal. So I constantly get people emails from people who say, you know, I've got issues, like I've got half of your issues, and I really want the rest to complete my set. How can I do that kind of thing? And so our content is, I love that about it, is that it's very evergreen and people collect it and it stays close to them. It's part of their collection of things at home, which is really nice. And then our podcast, that's fairly new. We launched that in November. I am the host of it, and it's been great, actually. That medium has been one that I can really, really connect to. And I think that there's something about listening to content, like through sound, when everything else is stripped away and that's all that you're left with, is really powerful. And so we can really dig into the conversation and get talking with people who are living their life in this really complete, fully immersed way. And it's been a really big thing for us. So we're just sort of launched it to see how viable it would be, and we're getting a lot more strategic about it now that we have a bit of strength on that platform. But it's been really good.
We print a few more than that. We print 50,000 copies an issue in the U.S. and 30,000 in Canada, which frankly is a small amount relative to the size of the country. Obviously, 50,000 is not an awful lot. That has led us into a sort of a different distribution model, and that's that we're very concerned about the number of readers per copy. 50,000, I mean, it's such a drop in the bucket type of thing. We place 35,000 of our copies in doctors' waiting rooms, targeted doctors. 8,000 go into allergists. Now, as an interesting sidebar to the whole strategic partner arrangement, first of all, lists for these doctors came from our partners. They're proprietary lists. They trusted us enough to share them. Okay. They went one better. They actually wrote introductions to the doctors on our behalf, saying that this is a publication that has some worth and some quality, and it's the type of thing that is very, you know, could be very valuable for your patients. We got our distribution because of that. Now, what that does, obviously, I guess, is it gives you multiple readers per copy. We were fortunate enough when we went in that a fairly large study had been done by Time Magazine and the Magazine Publishers of America, and basically what it said was that the average magazine sitting in a doctor's office gets 30 readers, okay, which was consistent with studies that we had seen that had been done in Canada. The thing that's interesting there is that most of the publications that were measured were weeklies, we're quarterly, and we're also highly relevant to the areas so we're in. So, I mean, if somebody is into an allergist office for a food allergy issue, and there's a magazine dealing with food allergy sitting on the table, I think the chances of it being picked up are probably higher than other publications, plus we're there for a longer period of time. So it managed to get our readership up to the point that it was capable of moving the needle for advertisers. I think that if we were just restricted to a single reader per copy, or your standard 2 or 2.5 readers per copy that you see a lot of magazines do, it would be a much more difficult sale when you're dealing with large pharmaceutical companies and who are a lot of our advertisers are. So those are our sort of numbers for printing.
Across the US or just
the States? No, we're national in the US.
Any more questions right now? Yes.
Okay, this will probably be two questions in one for you. With Allergic Living, do you print locally in the U.S., or is all the printing done here in Canada?
Originally, it was done in Canada. Now it's all being done in the U.S. It's being done in Wisconsin by a Chicago-based company called Quad Graphics that I think is now they've just acquired another company called Brown Publishing, and I think they're now the largest publisher. And the reason, in part, was printing costs. Their quality is extremely good, and it's not to say that there aren't good Canadian printers, because there are. Probably the biggest difference from our standpoint was the mail costs. They have a very sophisticated mail system where they have their own fleet of trucks, and they basically do deliveries to about, I think, 15 or 20 geographic locations across the U.S. So, I mean, if you took a big market, let's say you're talking Houston, they would have trucks going into Houston and trucks going into Los Angeles and various parts, and it really gets the mail out quicker, and it's more cost efficient. So, I mean, it really helped our distribution costs pretty dramatically.
Okay. Now, for Celine, does the cover price go up with the costs of distribution and shipping and all that?
Well, yes, but that's all, it's at the discretion of the retailer. So we have a wholesale set price, and then they're free to adjust it depending on their market and how their distance and things like that. So.
I'm wondering, Celine, if you feel comfortable talking a bit more about the content licensing experience that you had, and what didn't work about it? Because it's always been, it seems like it's an intriguing opportunity to, you know, find new revenues for established content. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you have very strong images, very strong editorial. I'm not sure what the deal with your writers is and whether there's royalties, and that just sort of compounds. Can you walk us through that a little bit?
Yeah, it's not an opportunity that I would be closed to again. I think in this case, it was perhaps just the particular relationship that we had. So here's something interesting. I do not have a traditional model, but they did. And so they, being in France specifically, I guess the eco-living market in France is pretty small, and because they went the traditional newsstand way, they were dealing with certain challenges that I wasn't. And so they partially got their content through us, and partially were sourcing their own content just to stay relevant because they were tied to a place and a market. And so they had their own set of challenges and then I had mine. And I wasn't in a position to tailor my content based on their needs, which is what they wanted. So in that case, it just didn't work because of that particular relationship. So that was the main thing with that.
Any other questions? So, Peter, when we were preparing for this, you mentioned, and you touched on it a little while ago as well, just the position of allergic living within the community and becoming a spokesperson within the community, but also like an advocate. You'd mentioned the Twitter parties when we were talking before this. Could you talk a bit about them? Because that was really interesting community engagement.
The Twitter parties, we actually do helping the largest allergist group in the U.S. Interestingly, they turned to us because they liked our social media and some of the things that we do on our social media. And we have been a partner with the allergists, and actually the Mayo Clinic has been involved in some of them as well. And it's interesting stuff for us because it's continuing to introduce us to some of the more influential, interesting players in the U.S., and it's given us sort of credibility. I mean, Celine's mentioned the word community a lot in sort of the things that she said today, and I think that probably that's what has set us apart. And our business definitely took, a turn upwards when we spent some time working on our social media. I think there's absolutely no question about that. I guess 3 or 4 years ago, we engaged a person that was sort of expert in the area to sort of really start teaching us what it was all about and how to build it. And it's been absolutely wonderful for us because it really has increased this sense of community. And it's also helped us in other ways because, I mean, when I mentioned getting on news stories and trying to get sort of right on the front of the curve on stuff because it draws business to your website, social media is the way we break the stuff. I mean, the FDA cumin thing, we had it out to 60,000 people and they were retweeting it everywhere. I mean, it was, here's where you go if you want to learn about this. This is really important, and it's just breaking right now. And I mean, the speed of it was, obviously with a magazine, you can't wait for 3 months till the next issue goes out the door. I mean, the magazine is useless for that particular purpose.
Yeah. Celine, do you have anything to add to that? I mean, you've mentioned how critical social media and your online presence is, and obviously you began as a digital publication.
Yeah. For us, the platforms that we really leverage are the visual ones, so Instagram, Facebook, and Pinterest. So we get probably a huge proportion of our online traffic from Pinterest, and a fairly large proportion from Facebook as well. It's difficult to gauge how much we're getting from Instagram because they don't direct link within your posts, but I would say that Instagram is our most robust platform in terms of user engagement. So for us, that's been really key, is to focus on those platforms, the social media platforms that encourage visual content. But it's made a massive difference. And we have, we started a hashtag project on Instagram called PGM in Season, which has spiraled into a really big project. I'm a little daunted by it, but it's fantastic because we have contributors, hundreds of contributors, for this one particular project that all began just as a campaign for 1 month on Instagram that's now yielded this project. We've had over 4,000 submissions for it, and that's entirely driven through Instagram. So, yeah.
Okay. We're going to wrap up. I asked Celine and Peter to provide any top tips, any the most salient observations or points. Do you care to share? Do you have any to share?
Yeah. For I think one thing that's really absolutely key is to be rock solid on your core brand messaging is in your aesthetics so that you can be as consistent as possible. That's something that we're complimented on a lot is the consistency within our across our publication, across all of our platforms. I wanted you to be able to see some content that we've produced and be able to recognize that that is pure green. And we've been successful in that, and I think that that's absolutely been key. The other thing is to know your market. I had some surprises, and I'm not sorry for them, but they were all part of the growing process. But the market from print only to online only and now to audio is you'd think that they were similar, but they're not. They're vastly, vastly different. And so every time that we have introduced a new platform, it's almost like starting from square one at the outset. Now we have the benefit of having this web of content and each feeds the other because we're strategic in that, but it took a while to build to that. And then the other thing, I guess my last thing is to really be innovative in what you're doing in your model. Because we're not newsstand, because we don't fit into the traditional molds, we've really, really had to think outside the box. And you know, one of the things that we're working on this year is how to leverage the really strong online presence that we have. So, you know, as Peter said, getting subscribers to your print product is difficult, and there are logistical challenges with that. With online, it's a completely different thing, and it's actually a lot, your conversion rate is a lot simpler. So we've started a three-tiered content strategy online where we have content that's completely free and clear. And when I say that, I mean that you can just log onto our website and you can just read it like a blog. And then we have a second tier of content where we ask for an opt-in. So you have to join our community to gain that content. So that's sort of our second level. And it's still free, but they're giving us their email, and two things happen there. Now we can track their behavior. We know exactly what they're interested in. We can gauge our audience engagement a little bit better. And then two, they're now sort of in our I hesitate to use the word social, sales funnel, but kind of. So we take them on a, move them through our content in such a way that they convert to a paying digital subscriber, and then they convert to a paid print subscriber. Because print is still where you're going to get the most value, is where the interaction lies with the content. And so we continuously get the feedback that content is where people are most highly engaging with the content, is what they enjoy the most. But having this three-tiered system has worked out extremely advantageously. And it's also given us a really excellent sample audience that we can survey, and we keep that going on an ongoing basis so that we know how our audience's interests are shifting. Lots and lots of different useful knowledge that we're gaining from surveying our existing readership as well. So, yeah, I love that. Good.
I guess Marst, our point before we went to the U.S. in a major way, we sort of sat through and thought what our options were strategically with the business, and I guess probably the model for a lot of magazines back when we made that decision was Cottage Life. Cottage Life was doing some wonderful things. They had trade shows that were robust, and they were heading in towards TV, and I mean there was all kinds of good things happening there. They were doing merchandising through and everything. Those things were all possibilities for us. We consider the idea of getting into the trade show business as a supplemental activity for revenue. We could have stayed totally in Canada and branched out and done that. There were certainly allergic living store possibilities with various types of products, things, whether it's EpiPen holders or whatever. I mean, we had the sales outlet in terms of the magazine there. We could have done that and partnered with somebody very easily. We talked about doing a restaurant certification program where we could have done testing and certified people online and gotten into that. There were all kinds of possibilities. We wanted to kind of stay closer to what it was we did. We're magazine people, and we've learned to be, I think, pretty good from a digital standpoint. Sort of that was sort of a secondary thing that came to us. But by going to the U.S., we were able to expand our revenue and stay close to what we did. So that would be, the very, very first thing. I think you go into any market, I mean, it's the same question you'd have launching a business in Canada, and that's, does this market need it? And I mean, that for us was fairly easy. The next step was going to be, can we just take what we've got and move it down there, or do we have to create a different product? Mm-hmm. And that awareness of what content was needed, I mean, we very quickly came to the conclusion that we weren't content exporters, we were content developers, and a lot of what we were going to do to be successful down there had to be content development. I think the next thing, once you've made the decision that you're going to go and you know what your product is going to look like, the question is, how do you establish it? I mean, it's daunting going into a country the size of the U.S. And if there are people down there with shared interest and a shared sense of community that you can partner with in a productive way, by all means use them, because I'm not sure we would have been anywhere near as successful as we've been in the U.S. without the strength of our partners. We have definitely contributed to what they do. We have supported them. We've given their work visibility. I mean, it's very much a two-way street. I mean, it's not us just going asking for their help. We've done a lot to help them along. But if there's somebody on the ground in a new location and you can engage them and get them in your corner working with you, it just saves so much groundwork. I mean, these organizations, I mean, one of them had been in business for over 50 years. They had chapters in 20 cities around the U.S. with people. So, I mean, you engage them and you get the strength of what they've got on the ground to begin with. So, I mean, if you go to a new market and it's not one of a number of markets, but it's just a tight focus on like a single place like the U.S., if you can get help there, go get it. I guess the other thing is that the first year or year and a bit that you're there, frankly, it's hell administratively, something we expected. We made some mistakes. We changed some resource people in terms of accountants and stuff. It was a bit of a slog getting going in terms of incorporating and getting set up with the IRS and our accountants and everything like that. If there's somebody who's gone through it before you and they can give you some advice, take it, because you can save yourself an awful lot of legwork. I sort of took a look at what was out there in terms of magazines that had taken the plunge ahead of us, and boy, there wasn't much. Modern Dog out in the West Coast had gone into Seattle and some of the West Coast. Hockey News was a big success, just because they know what a great hockey team we've got here. You know, I didn't have many people that I could turn to, but there were some, and I think that's one of the things that interested Matt a little bit when they were so supportive of us going south the border, is that there could be somebody like me that maybe had gone through it that could maybe provide some help for other Canadian publications that are thinking of taking the plunge. And I would be certainly glad to do that. If anybody's planning on doing that, just give me a call and I'll be glad to share what we've learned and the things that we've done right and some of the resources that we draw on, because we now have a really excellent team of people working for us, but we did not have all of them from the get-go, that's for sure.
Thank you. Any final questions? So strong themes of developing your community of interest, quality of content, a certain agility in kind of moving where you need to move, following those signs. I think you can all appreciate the experience and generosity that Peter and Celine have brought to this morning. So thank you very much.